Hi, you're watching Newsworthy Minis. It's our weekly dose of a powerful idea in a short, compact snippet. In light of the Supreme Court's recent observation that farmers cannot sit in protest while challenging the validity of farm laws in courts, this snippet of political scientist and public intellectual Pratap Bhanu Mehta is of extreme significance. In this lecture, organized by Project 39A in December of 2020, Pratap Bhanu Mehta speaks of why people protest and what happens if they protest before exhausting democratic remedies available to them.
But let's for a moment grant this point. Look, you have freedom of expression in a democracy. Use words, write, petition, make arguments, right? If words work, if the logic of arguments work, protest should not be necessary, right? Moreover, in a democracy, we can supposedly cashier the rulers for their misconduct, right? We can throw them out at the next election. So what more do you want by way of dissent? You can speak what you want. You can vote what you want, right? And in a sense, the bounds of legitimate activity are in a sense governed or enabled by these modes of expression. The problem with a dissenter in a democracy is the dissenter claims unilateralism, right? The dissenter sets themselves up as a final judge and arbiter against court, against parliament, and sometimes even against public opinion, right? So here is the paradox that the honorable justices might be hinting at when they say, certain forms of protest are not appropriate to a liberal democracy. When they say in a democracy, you don't need protest and dissent in quite the same way. The thought is, in a perfectly functioning democracy, all relevant moral considerations have been taken into account. All discussions have taken place. Respect due to all persons as free and equal has been granted. Right? Why would you need dissent? Now, you might be tempted to respond, but that's exactly the point. Our democracy is deeply flawed. The representative process is not a responsive process. The rule of law is intermittent, and by God, the Supreme Court is making sure it's intermittent. And at best, often our democracy does little to protect the vulnerable and the marginalized. Right? It's a perfectly good response to make to this worry. You might go further. You might say the court wants us to, in protesting, abide by our civic obligations. But you might say, are these civil obligations binding on people who do not have a fair share in this scheme of cooperation? Right? If the basic scheme of social cooperation itself does not respect freedom, equality, and dignity of persons, right? Why should the onus of cooperating on civic obligations follow on those protesting, right? Think of, in a sense, the Adivasis, right? One group that, in a sense, has got the worst end of every state, colonial state, democratic state, right? Authoritarian state, right? Why should the burden of abiding by these civic obligations fall only on them in the absence of a framework that grants them minimal standing and reciprocity? Why are courts and parliament so keen to remind us of our duties only when there is a protest? What about reminding those who have the power to draw the larger social contract? Right? Does not protest serve as an epistemic function of drawing attention to a problem that might otherwise go unnoticed in a democracy? Do we still have an obligation if the social contract does not recognize us as free and equal? And so we want to say, look, protest is important. These are people, these are our fellow citizens protesting in the name of a higher order rule. Allow them to redeem the promise of democracy by bringing neglected concerns to your attention. Okay, this is a perfectly sensible answer to give. Why won't we give this answer? Now it turns out the problem is more complicated. It's not an easy answer to give. It sounds easy to give. That's what we always say, right? But ours is not a perfect democracy. It needs the safety valve. No Supreme Court can admit that there is no rule of law in India in parts. No parliament can admit that we are not a deeply representative democracy, right? So in a sense, giving this answer that our formal institutions are imperfect, right, is already in some senses putting a question mark over their legitimacy, which they cannot accept. Okay? Sometimes you don't concede to this answer because politics is a partisan game and you do not want to concede to the other side. Whether we are right or wrong, whether the protesters are right or wrong is immaterial. What is important is they be defeated, right? So you see protests only in the framework of a kind of tactical negotiation. So suppose you protest, right? The Shaheen Bagh protesters protested. Punjab farmers are protesting. If the protest and dissent is expressed before all other formal means of redress, right? Elections, maybe, courts of law, maybe, petitioning your MP, maybe, right? Using the public sphere and writing, maybe, whatever. If you protest before all other formal means of redressing your problem have been exhausted, then the court will say, well, isn't this protest unfair? Right? Why don't you use these settled means to convey what you want to convey? On the other hand, you can have another scenario where you have engaged all of these means. You have knocked at the door of the Supreme Court. You have knocked at the door of Parliament. You have petitioned every politician. You have got, you know, every useless columnist to write an op-ed, right? Everything that a democracy allows you under free expression. And yet, the outcome is something that is deeply, deeply detrimental to the principles of liberal democracy. Maybe it's discriminatory. In which case, if you protest after the fact, the retort is, but look, you're engaging in unilateralism, right? How can you set yourself up as sovereign over what is right after Parliament has pronounced and after the court has pronounced, right? So here's, in a sense, the paradox. If you dissent and protest before all procedural remedies are exhausted, you're a troublemaker. If you dissent and protest after all remedies have been exhausted, right, you are basically a unilateral anarchist. So when faced with genuine dissent, in a sense, this prospect of a withdrawal of consent, or this puncturing of the myth of consent, this puncturing of the legitimacy that the state is claiming in respect to that matter, the state's option that becomes is you want to deny those who are dissenting this way their standing. You want to say that their seeming performance or threat of a withdrawal of consent, they're enacting a refusal to recognize the legitimacy of a law, does not count because they are violating some basic civic obligations. And the only way in which you can do this is by de facto criminalizing them. The attack on dissent is not so much an attack on those particular ideas. Often it is. The government just doesn't like those ideas, right?